Hi, everybody, and welcome to today's Värt att veta, Worth Knowing. Today it will be in English, and as you all know, this lecture will be broadcasted, and I will invite you to ask questions after the lecture, so we get the questions on the movie, the film. And I would also like you to notice that if you talk, ask questions, or stand in front of the camera, you will be in the film. And now I will go over to Swedish for a while, because I would like to tell you a bit about the program for this spring. So, today we have the role of mixed forest in changing climate. Den 11:e så har vi nyckelbiotoper, forskning om skogens pärlor med Lena Gustafsson. 25:e från lejonjägare till lejonväktare, Ingela Jansson. 8:e så har vi ett nyinsatt föredrag med Hjalmar Laudon. Vart är vi på väg? Storskaliga förändringar i vattenkvaliteten kräver nytänk i skogen. 22:e, skogsdebatten och idén om naturlighet under 1900-talet med Jimmy Jönsson. 6:e, fjällnära skog, dåtid, nutid och framtid, Johan Svensson. Och sen kommer vi också att extra insatt den 27 maj, men det kommer mer information om det senare. But back to today's lecture that will be held by Jorg Aldea from all the way from Alnarp, Southern Swedish Forest Research Center. And Jorg will talk about the role of mixed forest in a changing climate. So welcome.
Thank you so much for your introduction, Pernilla. And good afternoon, everyone. For me, it's a great honor to stay here and talk a little bit about the mixed stands and the role of the mixed stands in to face the ongoing climate change. As Pernilla say, I am a postdoc in the Southern Swedish Forest Research Center. I'm studying the growth and the drought resilience difference between mixed stands and pure stands. And well, what is the role of the mixed forest compared with monocultures? This picture, the first picture, it was taken from a paper from Adam Felton and some colleagues from the department, and they compared the outcomes between the mixed stands and pure stands. And what they found is, for example, in this picture, you can see the outcomes of spruce and birch mixtures compared with the spruce monocultures. And one could expect, for example, that in an ongoing climate change, it could be a risk, an increase of risk of wind throw, of pathogens, of pests, and so on, and drought and fire, for example. And if you see the picture, the mixtures could take some advantage compared with the monocultures in this way. So probably mixtures could have a very important role to face the ongoing climate change compared with monocultures. Of course, there is not always a positive outcome from mixtures. If you see, for example, what happens with browsing, for sure, spruce monocultures have more advantage compared with mixtures. But if you take into account the overall picture, if you can see the blue arrows, it seems like the mixed stands could make some take some advantage, a very good positive outcomes compared with monocultures. But all of these outcomes are usually they have not market value, and sometimes that's the reason because we don't see in the field or in the landscapes so much mixed stands compared with monocultures. And that's, I think, is one of the main reasons. And sometimes, from a silvicultural perspective, with much with the forest owner's perspective point of view, there are some differences with this great important roles of the mixed stands compared with monocultures. So we're going to see two examples. The first example is what happened in Scots pine and Norway spruce mixed stand. And this picture was taken from another paper published by Emma Hobstrom, another colleagues from the department. And they compare what happened with the stand volume in monocultures compared with the mixed stands of Scots pine and Norway spruce. If you can see in the picture, the mixed stands produce, they support more standing volume compared with the monocultures of Norway spruce. But in contrast, the stand volume of Scots pine in monocultures is bigger compared with the mixtures. So if we take into account the productivity of mixtures, it looks like it's a little bit lower compared with the monoculture of Scots pine. The authors also compare what happens in the mixed stands compared with a theoretical mixed behavior, and they see that there is no significant difference. Another example is, the second example is about Scots pine and birch mixed stands. This is taken from one paper published from Finland, but I think the condition in the field is quite similar than here in Sweden. If you see the picture on top and left, you can see what is the evolution of the mean annual volume increment compared with the proportion of birch proportion. So what you can see there is that when the proportion of birch increases, the mean annual volume increment decreases. So it means, like, again, for the pure stands of Scots pine, the production is bigger compared with mixtures. And the main reason you can find in the second picture, in the below and right, and that's the main reason. You can see the evolution of the mean annual diameter and the proportion of birds. If you can see this trend, it seems like there is a trend where the growth diameter of Scots pine is reducing because of the proportion of birds. So it means like there is a kind of competition between these two species, birds and Scots pine. When they are mixed in the stands, the production is lower compared with the monocultures of Scots pine. Nowadays, I'm working also with the Swedish Forest National Inventory data and with a grant that I get from the Environmental Monitoring and Assessments Program from SLU. We showed that when Scots pine is mixed with birch, the drought resilience also decreases with the proportion of birch. And it's agreed with these results. When we have mixed stands of birch and pine, the production is lower, and sometimes the drought resilience is also lower compared with monocultures. So it looks like there is a kind of trade-off in terms of productivity and drought resilience if we compare the monocultures and mixed stands. It looks like if we want to have good productivity, we have to focus on the pure stands, and we want to have another values, outcomes, for example, recreational value, or resilience against pathogens or other risks like fire or for example, pests, we have to focus on mixed stands. Looks like this. This is a kind of trade-off. But sometimes not always happens in this way. Sometimes we have good news. For example, if you can see the picture at left, it is taken also, again, from the work of Emma Holson, the department. When they compare the mixture stands of Scots pine and spruce, and they see this is the diameter distribution of Scots pine when it's in mixtures compared with monocultures. As you can see, the diameter distribution, there is a negative skewness. So what it means is like the growth, the diameter of trees of a Scots pine in mixtures are usually higher compared with monocultures. We know that comparing monocultures than mixtures, monocultures produce more than mixtures, but in mixtures, the size of diameter in the Scots pine in this site was higher. So it means like the tree is a big size, so it means like could be a bigger quality of timber. So maybe we can get some extra incomes because of this, which could compensate the low production with a high quality of timber. In fact, there are some studies, some authors would make some simulation with models, and they found that the net present value comparing the monocultures and mixtures are almost the same. They are very close. So there is no, sometimes there is no so difference in terms of economic value compared monocultures with mixed stands. So in spruce and Scots pine mixtures, the big size of Scots pines maybe could compensate the lower productivity. And the second picture at right is a photograph. It's because it's called the Nurse effect. When a conifer grows in under the broadleaves, sometimes some authors found that in this situation, the growth production of mixed stands are bigger compared with monocultures of spruce. And this is because of the Nurse effect that I say before, that the protection of broad-leaf trees sometimes could protect to the conifer seedlings against the freezing or against the low temperatures. So if you compare sometimes in young stands, the production in mixtures compared with monocultures, sometimes is bigger in mixtures compared with monocultures. And this is one of the reasons, the Nurse effect. But that is not always so simple. Sometimes we have a big problem with the forest management of mixed forests. We know perfectly how it works, the monocultures, how we must to plant it, when we have to thin in, how much we must to thin in, but we don't have enough knowledge about the mixtures, how to manage the mixture. We have no idea what is the intensity of the thinning, how frequently we have to thin in, and we don't know what is the proportion of species we have to respect to get maximum goal of recreational values, of timber value, or economic values. But this lack of knowledge is not empty. For example, these two guys who work in the department, they publish some papers. They did some studies 30 years ago from silviculture of mixed stands. So we have nowadays some knowledge, but maybe it's not enough. But at least I think we are in the best way to try to understand how the mixed stands they are working and functioning. And we still are working and researching with the silviculture of mixed stands. Experienced people, experienced researchers like Professor Urban Nilsson, Emma Holmström, Magnus Love, they are working also in the silviculture of mixed stands to get a future silviculture for mixed stands to face the ongoing climate change. So the knowledge is becoming and increasing. And that's all that I would like to show you, that it looks like there is a trade-off between production and other outcomes of mixed stands, and there is also a complex of management mixed stand compared with monocultures, but sometimes mixed stands could be very useful in terms of production and also in terms of other external values, like recreational or resilience against pest. And we are advanced with the knowledge of how to manage the mixed stands. I would like to say thank you so much for the organization of this speech, for inviting me to talk here about mixed forests. I would like also to say hello to my daughter who is watching me right now, hola Julia. And I would like to say thank you so much to all of you who have listened to me. Thanks for your attention.
Well, some questions. I can start with a question. If you had your own forest, how would you manage it? Would it be a mixed stand or would it be a mono stand?
This is a very, very, very tricky, difficult question. Yeah. And a difficult question don't have an easy answer. But yes, for sure, if you have a, it depends what is the site also. There are a lot of factors which depends of your election. But that's true, you are focused, you are thinking in production. Probably you are thinking in a monoculture of Scots pine or Norway spruce, it depends of the site. But also, nowadays we are looking now that there is no very low snow here and something is changing with climate change. We don't know how to manage by the moment in the good way the mixed stands. But I think it could be useful if we can think about to change our mind and think that mixture stands could be useful for the future. Maybe if I have a owner, probably I will try start to mix a little bit in a small proportion some species. Maybe not big proportion, but sometimes, as I told you, it works if you have a plantation of Norway spruce and birch. If the proportion of birch is not so high, the growth in young stands increases. So it's a good idea to combine both species. And after that, after the thinnings, probably you can remove one of these species. And for example, remove birch and stay with the Norway spruce. So probably the income and the production of timber also, and with other recreational values and resilience against pest and so on, could increase also. So my point of view is if I have an owner, I will try to combine species. I start to think about it.
Some more questions? Yes.
You missed one thing. One of the nurture effects that's quite significant based on my personal experience is protection against grazing from moose on the mm-hmm. young plants. If you do not clear away the leaf, the birch, the alder, and similar trees, and leave them maybe half a meter tall at the time you plant your conifers, then the leaf plants will protect against moose grazing, because whenever they can take one or two plants and they have to eat the whole, but they cannot walk around, just take the tops and take mm-hmm. every plant, because the leaf trees are in the way. And mm-hmm. it's a significant impact in areas with lots of moose. And the second thing is, one of the biggest effects that you can have from mixing trees, I have experience from my mother's forest, about 20 hectares of forest, is when you have varying degrees of water over a stretch of land. If you mix, you mix pine, you mix spruce, maybe 50-50, 60-40, and you also leave the leaf plants, whichever grows the best in that area will be the dominant tree, and you will maximize production based on a varying stretch of land.
Thank you for your comments. I think I agree with your vision.
Yes.
Thank you for a very nice presentation.
Thank you so much.
I work on conifers and like spruce and pine. And I was just thinking, like, for example, pine is just a shade intolerant species. So if you plant it along with birch, birch will grow faster than pine, and then probably it has an effect because it's a shade intolerant one. So it will be always under shade with other birch trees which are growing faster than it. So have you thought over these kind of issues or something?
Yeah, the mixture effect, it depends on the kind of the species which are mixture, of course. For example, in your case, when Scots pine is mixed with birch, as far as I know, the unread, the growth of Scots pine decreasing with the proportion of birch. So it means like the Scots pine suffer with the competition of birch. So that's probably no good mixture of this species. So maybe it's more efficient if you mix Norway spruce and birch, because of you say about the shade tolerance of a spruce compared with pine. Yeah, exactly. Norway spruce is a shade tolerance species. Yeah.
Okay, more questions? Yes, good.
Have you seen any trials with mix with larch with any of the others?
No, I have no idea about the mixer stance with larch. I'm so sorry. But it's a good point. Maybe in the future, well, there's a lot of things to study in the future because we don't have enough ideas, clear ideas how to manage the mixer stance. But it could be a good idea. And it makes me think in future research. Thank you.
When you talk about the mixture, how you define the spatial distribution of mixture? Is it like every second tree you have mixture, or landscape scale, then one plot can be one species and the other plot is different species? If you look from the airport, no, airplane, then there'll be also mixture. So how you define, and what do you think the how could you maximize the mixture effect by distributing spatially?
I think it's a good question. In the studies that I have talked about, they are experimental design, mixing trees tree by tree. So there is no grouping or gaps of trees. So as far as I know, if you mix tree by tree, you have these results. If you compare spruce and pine in mixtures, it seems like mixtures produce lower than monoculture of pine. But I have no idea what happens if the mixture depends of the if they are clustered or they are randomly distributed. Probably you have different outcomes, different results. So it's a good question also, but difficult to answer. But the most of the researchers have focused in the tree by tree mixture, no in cluster. But it's a good, probably the results differ. They are different if you take into account cluster design or a random design. Yeah. Good question, but I have no answer.
Yes.
Do you think mixture effects can also be observed, or do you think we can have mixture effects on the below ground soil carbon?
As far as I know, there are not so much manuscript papers we talk about this, but I know one paper that I read from one colleague in Spain who was focused on what happened in the nutrients of soil between comparing the mixture of two kind of pines, two Mediterranean pines, and she found that in the mixtures, in the soil of mixtures, there is more more nitrogen or more ratio nitrogen carbon or something like this. So it's a good effect when there are two species mixture. But I know one expert of this, but I at least in this paper, when they compare this in the south of Europe, they compared this mixture pine, two species of pine, and they found good results for from mixtures. Yeah, below ground.
Okay, I think we draw the line there with questions, and you are able to stay a few minutes.
Yes, for sure.
Then we can invite you all to come here and ask more questions. But first of all, we thank you for a very good talk and a lot of great questions. Thank you.
Thank you.